Father, we thank you this morning for the precious Holy Spirit. Jesus, you said if you'd go away, you'd send a comforter, and he'd be with us forever. Lord, we're so grateful this morning for the Sunday school lesson we've had on substitution. Lord, I'm grateful that the Holy Ghost can sweep across the strings of my heart. And Lord, I can feel the presence of the truth of righteous doctrine. Jesus, you died in our place for our sins. And that's the only reason that we have any basis of being here this morning. God, we have gathered to worship you. I'm so glad that you set aside the first day of the week to worship you. Lord, what a blessing it is to rest in worship. Lord, we thank you for this congregation that thou hast gathered together here today. We're thankful, Lord, for the people of God. We're thankful, Lord, that you've raised up, Lord, this work. I pray, God, today that you'd help me to preach. Lord, without you, I can do nothing. You know, Lord, that while we're going through Timothy here, it's kind of a special time to me. And I just pray, oh God, that it be you here today. And that it's been prayed so many times, I'd be hid behind the shadow of the cross. And folks would see Jesus lifted up and be drawn to him. Lord, today I pray that the power of God would be at work while I preach. Lord, you're able to do what needs to be done in all of our lives. I pray, Lord, save the lost. I pray, God, encourage the laborers. Give strength, Lord, to every person. Keep every marriage in this church house together. Lord, don't let nobody divorce in here, I pray. Lord, give every child in this church a daddy and a mama. Unless, Heavenly Father, they've been providentially removed. God, then you'll be their father. Lord, we pray today that you'd help us. Lord, give us grace to humble ourselves before you, to be honest in our heart, and to be honest with you. Lord, again, I just thank you for all this service. I thank you for the songs and the singing. And I thank you, Lord, for the testimonies. I thank you for the Bible class. I thank you, Lord, just to be with you this morning. It's good, and I thank you for it. In Jesus' name, help me preach. Amen. Amen. 1 Timothy chapter 1. I pick up kind of where I left off for preaching through the first book of Timothy. I don't know how all this will go because it's been a little different experience for me. I've probably, let me count here, 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. I'm in my 31st time reading through in this Bible the book of 1 Timothy. I mark every time I read through, and according to my count right here, I mark, make a little mark, I'm 1, 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. I'm in my 31st time of reading through the book of 1 Timothy. And I don't know whenever God's touched my heart as He has this time as I've been reading through it and trying to preach in the book of 1 Timothy. I think it has something to do with the fact that last month on the 24th of January, I was in 1982, it'd be what, 82 from 2009? 27 years. 27 years the ministry just passed the other day. And there's some things I picked up that I'd never caught before. And man alive, I tell you, it's just blessed me. It's just been a blessing. I'm not down and I'm not sad and I'm not gloomy. I don't know why I'm crying. I'm just happy in the Lord, all right? Just thankful. But I don't ever want to get a hard heart. I don't want to ever get dry-eyed. I want to be able to feel the presence of God in my soul. But we picked up at verse number 11 last week, or whenever it was, according to the glorious gospel. We preached on the fact that our gospel is a glorious, glorious gospel. Man alive, I tell you what, it's good news. Amen. And it's glorious. We've got a glorious Savior. We've got a glorious salvation. We've got a glorious future. And we preached on that. And then we preached on the next thing of the blessed God. And man alive, I got good and happy preaching on the blessed God. He is blessed, amen. Y'all been practicing that deal? Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that's within me. Bless His holy name. You ain't never said that. Y'all try it, son. But get off in the closet and try it. It's just real quiet. It won't hurt you, amen. And then drive down the highway. Ain't nobody with you. And kind of get a little louder. It'll be all right. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that's within me. Bless His holy name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits. And I'll tell you what, you ought to learn to bless the Lord. He is a blessed God. And now I'm going to just take off right here. And this is where we're going to pick up. We're just going to graze through the pastures this morning. That be all right? They're just sheep. We're sheep of God's pasture. We're going to graze in the Word of God today. Feed on it. He said, which was committed to my trust. What was committed to Timothy, to Paul's trust? That glorious gospel was committed to his trust. Now let me tell you something. I want you to underline the word trust. Trust is a word that needs to get back into the vocabulary of the American people. It needs to get back into the vocabulary of churches and church folk. It needs to get back in the vocabulary of married folk. It needs to get back in the vocabulary of young people. And you need to learn to be a man of trust. Trust. He said God had committed this glorious gospel to my trust. What a thought. Man, I tell you what, I meditated on that. And I thought, good land of living, you mean God has committed the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ to me? And I tell you what that do. That'll humble you. That'll break you down. That'll get you off your high horse. When you think that God has committed to your trust the message of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. He's entrusted us with a message. You know, this church is entrusted with a message. And we've got a message. We've got a glorious gospel. And it's easy to talk about, but what are we going to do with it? Paul said, I've got a glorious gospel. I've got a blessed God. Now what am I going to do? He said, I've been entrusted with it by God Almighty. And what am I going to do with it? Now I'll say this. Number one, we better not misrepresent the message. We better not misrepresent this glorious gospel and pervert it and twist it and carve it out to suit our own lives. We better preach a gospel that's in this book exactly as it's in this book. And we better not just talk about it here, but we ought to proclaim it. And I guess that's what blesses my heart about hearing this man's testimony this morning. Because you send out 6,000 CDs, whatever, every month. And by the way, last week we started taking out a half-page ad every week in the shopper. You pray for that ad. And I'm saying to you that God wants us to proclaim it and get the word out. And I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation. And I'm just telling you that part of our thing that we're entrusted. God has entrusted this church. Think about that. God could have went down the street, folks. God could have went up the highway. God said, I'm looking for a church to entrust the church with a message. And I want it proclaimed. Boy, I want to tell you something. It's a blessing to me this morning to know that God has entrusted us. And we ought to take that as a sacred trust. Let me tell you something. I had a man walk up to me one time and he said, Reggie, I need to talk to you. He pulled me off the side. He said, Reggie, he said, my wife left me years ago. He said, I've got some boys I'm raising. He said, I'm gone on a truck a lot of times. And he said, I never know when I'm driving down the road whether I'm going to get head on or not. But he said, I need to talk to you about something. He said, I want to know, would you be a trustee for my children should I die? He said, I want to know, would you and Karen raise my children if I get killed out here on the highway? Reggie, I want to know, would you take care of what assets I have and make sure that my children get it and that it's done like I want it done? Reggie, could I trust you with that? I said, I'd do my best. He said, I wouldn't be asking you if I didn't think you could. You listen to me. Trust is a very valuable, valuable thing that God wants to give you freely. Don't blow it. Don't violate trust. We're entrusted with this glorious gospel in our families. Lady right back here come brought that little Samuel, isn't it? Which one's Samuel? Oh, right, the queen. Notice that's not... But the boy that was saved. John. But there was a Samuel back here. Is the oldest boy Samuel? Yeah, I met him the other day back here. John got saved the other day. The other evening. Now let me tell you something. God entrusts parents with the gospel to lead your children to Christ. God entrusted you with a child. And I never will forget when my first son was placed in my arms at Cox Medical Center up there and that nurse laid that little baby boy in my arms. And I never, ever, I remember the color of the blanket. I remember everything about it. And I can remember looking at him. And you know what? I never met him before. But I'll tell you something I realized. It hit me like a brick. I have entrusted you with someone who's going to spend eternity forever somewhere. Let me tell you a little something. I was religious at that point in my life, but I was not saved. But I'm glad for the inculcation of the truth of the fact that, you know, when something's placed in your arms, you have a trust. Brother Phil, you've got an unbelievable trust that God's committed to you. These little boys, these girls that are born in your family, I'm telling you something. What a trust, your children. Your children setting by you as a trust from Almighty God. What are you going to answer God when you stand before the throne about what He's entrusted you with? Have you given the glorious gospel to your children, or are you hoping some preacher does it somewhere? Have you ever set your children down and said, son, I want to tell you that Jesus Christ is God Almighty. He's God's only begotten Son. That He was born of the Virgin. That He came into this world, lived a sinless life, and suffered and died on the cross for our sins. We're a fallen creature. Your ancestor Adam fell in the garden, and it was passed on to us. And we've sinned against God, and all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And Christ died in your place on that old rugged cross and shed His blood. The wages of sin is death, and Jesus died in your place. Son, I want you to know that. Daughter, I want you to know that. I want to ask you this morning. Listen to me, this is serious business. You've been entrusted with an eternal soul with a child. Have you committed to give them the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ to your children? How about your grandchildren? Have you ever sat down with your grandchildren and said, son, I want to tell you something. I want to tell you how Grandpa got saved. I want to tell you when Grandma got saved. Are you taking care of the trust that God has given you as a parent and a grandparent with even our own children? It amazes me how many children grow up in a church, in a Christian home, quote, and their own mom and daddy has never talked about the realities of spiritual life to their own children. I'm telling you, there is no excuse for it. There is no alibi. You are going to stand, and I am going to stand before the judgment bar of Almighty God, and we're going to give an account to that which has been entrusted to us. And I want to encourage you today, if you've never done it, write a letter this afternoon. Call this afternoon. Tell your children the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. Let me tell you something. If you don't, somebody may never, or somebody may give them a false gospel. They need to hear it from you. Have you ever done that? We've been entrusted with the gospel to our relatives. We've been entrusted to our community, in our region, and yes, in the world. And I'm so thankful that God has entrusted us here at this church with the message. But what if I fail to do it? God says, Reggie, I'm going to trust you with this message of my son. And this is the only thing that'll keep people out of hell, Reggie. You got it in your hand that I've entrusted it with you. Let me tell you something that's not funny. When I think sometimes laying on the bed at night, the day I stand before God Almighty and what I've preached to people, you realize I'm going to give account of every word I've ever spoken, every deed I've ever done. And as a minister of the gospel, entrusted with the gospel, it is not going to be funny. Because God is, Brother Dean and Brother Donnie, a righteous, holy God. The Bible is very clear that whom He entrusts, let me tell you, more is expected of you when you've had things placed in your hands and in your trust. What if we failed to do it? That's why I'm compelled constantly, let's get the message out more and more. Let's do all we can do at this church. I don't want people living within 50-mile radius of this church and not hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. I don't want to be guilty of that, standing before God. Let me tell you something. We're building on back here. It's nice. I like it. It's everything. But you know something? Jake, you're doing a beautiful job laying tile back there. Appreciate it. Beautiful tiles don't save souls. Red padded pews don't save people. And I'll tell you, I'm thankful. I had a dear friend call me this week. You pray for him. He's a preacher. He's took a church And I don't want to go too deep in it, but he's having trouble. And it's the same old garbage of boards. And anybody know where the doctrine of boards is in church, in the Bible? Churches have boards. And listen, you know, and I'll tell you what, what about deacons, Randy? As far as I'm concerned, we got a lot of good deacons in this church. They don't have the name tag, but they do the job. Mm-hmm. But you know what a lot of pastors put up with? They got boards and deacons and stuff, and the pastor doesn't have any authority in the church. And you know why churches ain't doing nothing? Because they're all fighting over what's going to be decided, what they're going to do. Right. So they wind up doing nothing. And I'm going to tell you something. I'll tell you something, Brother Dan. You want to know one of the secrets of this church? Is that I'm the pastor of this church. I ask these people to trust me. I try to walk with God, we're going to go do something.
Amen.
And you know what? I don't mean I'm Lord over God's heritage. When I come up with a new idea, I think God would have us do, you know what I do? I watch the eyes of these people when I announce it. And the same Holy Ghost that's bearing witness with me will bear witness with these people. And if the light don't come on their eyes, it makes me wonder why. So I go back to the house and check it out again and say, God, it didn't look quite right there. I'm talking about the fact, though, that, hey, if I've got some bulldog back there with his teeth out and he's trying to fight everything, he don't even bother me. We're going on. We ain't having a vote about it. You know what? Lead, follow, or get out of the way. Is that what that boy said? And you say, I don't like that kind of stuff. Well, you ought to try it at your house. You might have a better home. Amen? That's what's mattered to a lot of men. I hear these men talking about, well, the preacher this, preacher that. They don't even leave their own homes.
Amen.
Well, anyway, good enough of that. Boy, I tell you what, I appreciate this water, sister. Y'all put up with me a little bit this morning. I don't know whether I'm preaching or meddling, but I'm doing one or the other. I am being nice, Brother Don. You just ain't got enough sense to realize it. Brother Dan, it's okay, man. He was real good friends, okay? I tell you what, I've often wondered what ministers think when they walk in here. Well, not only what if I fail to do it, what if I pervert the message? You ever think about what a Jehovah's Witness or a Mormon or if that stuff's going to do, the Pope's going to wind up doing it to hell and judgment?
Yeah.
Perverted the gospel of Jesus Christ that should have been entrusted to and led people to hell instead of telling people how to get to heaven. I'll tell you what, there's not a hotter spot in hell for a fault than there is for a false prophet and tell somebody, making people think they're going to heaven when they're busting hell wide open. Let me give you a little bit about trust this morning. Up here north of town one time, a great man as far as I'm concerned, him and his grandson was in a tractor. Let me tell you about trust. You listening? We're talking about trust. 5-year-old boy got in the tractor with his grandpa. Went down the little old road back in the farm there quite a ways. Went down there and the gate was down there and the grandpa got off the tractor to go open the gate. And that grandpa, while he was opening the gate, the tractor rolled. Ran over him. Crushed him. Was on top of him. Killing him. The little 5-year-old grandson jumped off the tractor, coming down there. Grandpa, grandpa. He said, son, listen real good to me. If you ever listen to grandpa, listen now. You have got to go for help. Grandpa's dying. You've got to go for help. And that little 5-year-old boy listened to it, took the trust of his grandpa's words, and ran up a road, long, long way. I think, if I'm not mistaken on the story, the first house wasn't nobody there. Went on to the second house until he found somebody to help his grandpa. What if that little boy said, well, I don't know, I want to go up here and chase rabbits for a while. I want to go this and do that and the other thing. You see, that little 5-year-old boy had been entrusted with a message. My grandpa's got a tractor on top of him. We need help. What if that little 5-year-old boy just went and a flower over here. He chased a chipmunk over here. You said that'd be a horrible thing. Somebody ought to teach that boy something. It's no different than you and I are when we're full grown and God entrusts us with things that we don't take care of. Let me give you a few things about it. God may entrust you with a spouse. June the 25th. I better get this right. June the 25th, 1977, God entrusted me with that little woman right there. He entrusted me to take care of her, provide for her, love her as Christ loved the church, make sure she didn't go hungry, make sure she had clothes to wear and a bed to sleep in, and plenty of kids to feed. No, God entrusted me with a sweet wife, but you know what? Let me tell you men something. A spouse is a trust. And you wives, a husband is a trust. And God's trusting you to take care of her. God's trusting you to love her. God's trusting you to take care of her. God's trusting you to provide for her. Now, you listen to me good. You may not like this. A man ought to provide for his wife.
Amen.
It is not Karen's job to win the bread at my home. Now, I'll tell you this much. I wouldn't get it done without her. And if I've had any success, I'm telling you what, 99% of it belongs to her and 1% to me.
Amen.
As far as on the human side. But I'll tell you this much. I don't expect her to bring home the bacon.
That's right.
Thank you, brother. That's one man in the house. Said, preach it. You listen to me. This world is destroying homes by the perversion of this biblical doctrine. God has entrusted you with a wife. Now, you know what the Bible says about the over in Proverbs chapter 13, but I found a matching verse for the husband. It talks about a husband, a faithful man who can find. We'll talk about that pretty soon if we get time. God may have entrusted you with children. God may have entrusted you with the family. God has a husband is to keep that family together. We're entrusted with something. Let me tell you something, the sickening thing in this world. I remember driving around the streets of Indianapolis up there with Brother Fields, driving up down them streets and him crying, said, there ain't a kid on this block got a daddy. There ain't a kid within a half a mile that hardly knows who his daddy is. Let me tell you something, they may be doing that in Indianapolis, but we don't have to do that in Norwood. Our children ought to know daddy, and they ought to be able to wake up one morning and say, good morning, daddy, and set the table with daddy. Eat breakfast with daddy and eat supper with daddy. That's all right. You don't have to say amen if you don't want to. I'm going to preach it anyway. You're entrusted with something. You're entrusted with something. It's not about you any longer. It's about your children. It's about taking care of what God gave you. By the way, you're entrusted with a pair of shoes once in a while. Don't make your mom and dad have to buy you a new pair of shoes every month. Take care of them. You're entrusted with the bedroom. Clean it up once in a while. You're entrusted with some teeth God gave you. Clean them once in a while. You see what I'm talking about? Y'all get the message? Pick it up, clean it. Hey, God may have entrusted some of you with a home, a farm, a house, a place to live in. Clean it up, pick it up. Make it look like God might want to live there. You know what? God said He wouldn't walk through the camp of the Israelites because it wasn't clean. He said that you that bear the vessels of the Lord, be you clean. Take care of what God entrusts you with. I like this kind of preaching. I don't care what he does. I'll find some place that does. Amen. God may entrust you with a business. Take care of it. Well, anyway, maybe I should try something else. This ain't flying real good. God's trust you with things. I want to ask you, can God entrust you? Trust is valuable life capital. Trust is capital. I'm talking about it's more precious than the cash in your pocket. Trust is so valuable capital. Did you know what? Let me tell you something. I get more business off trust than any other way. Are you listening to me? Let me give you a little illustration. Between 1991 and 1999, I sold out 853 or 56 dairy herds. Do you know what that means? That 856 people entrusted me to sell probably one of their biggest life's investments. I go out and do an auction for people. You know what it means? Basically, they're entrusting you. You know, this little idiot, this skinny idiot, to walk up there and not give everything away that they've got. Did you ever think about that? I remember when Doc Mitchum, I went in to see Doc Mitchum back in 1979. I was hurting in my belly. Didn't know what it was. Old Doc Mitchum, he said, well, he said, lay down on that table a little bit. And he felt around here and felt around there and said, where's it hurting at? And I'd tell him, yeah, right there. He backed up against his stand and said, how well do you like baby food? I said, I don't know. I don't remember ever eating any. He said, well, let me tell you one thing. He said, you're getting pre-ulcers, and if you don't quit worrying about them auctions, you're going to be eating it. Then he looked at me and said this. He said, Reggie, I'm an old man. I'm a doctor. He said, I don't save everybody that walks in this building. He said, some of them die on me. He said, I've had him die on me on the operating table and had to walk out and tell the wife or tell the kids I lost him on the operating table. But he said, let me tell you what I do. I give it my best to everybody that walks in this office. I give them my best because they're trusting their life with me. But he said, when I drive home, I leave it here and I don't take it home with me. He said, or I'd have ulcers and be dead and couldn't help you today. Now he said this to me. Are you giving them people your best when you go out there to do a sale for them? I said, why, sure, Doc. You're giving it all you got for them. You're doing your best for them. He said, you know, you're selling people out everything they've accumulated for 50 and 60 years, don't you? I said, yes, Doc. He said, all right, give it your best, and when you drive out the gate, forget it. You don't have to worry about it. If you've done the best you could do, and he said, if they've entrusted you to do the best you can do, he said, it's all you can do. But I'm telling you something, when you go to heaven, you better know, I did the best daddy, I was the best daddy I could be, I was the best mama I could be.
Amen.
I was the best preacher I could be. I was the best worker at that job I could be. Amen. 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 Trust is valuable life capital. Be careful how you spend it. Let me tell you something. My daddy gave me a name. Brother, I want to tell you something. I'll talk about him while he's alive. I ain't going to get up here and talk about him when he's dead. My daddy gave me a good name. I have never in my life had somebody walk up to me and say, "Your dad cheated me." I've had people call me up and say, "I don't know you, Reggie, from Adam's house, Cap, but I knew your daddy. I want you to come do a sale for me." Amen. Leave your kid something like that, would you? Amen. Leave your kid something like that. Give them some capital to make a living off of and to have something about life for them. Broken trust is like broken glass. Pretty near impossible to ever get it back like it was. Are you listening to me? The Bible said, "Virtuous woman, the heart of her husband doth safely trust in her, and he shall have no need of spoil." A virtuous woman, he said, her husband can be gone on the truck. He's not worried about her being with some man while he's gone. That's what I'm talking about. Virtuous man, he can be out there on the truck and his wife's not worried about him stopping at the porn shop. That's what we're talking about. Trust! I thought I was going to be nice this morning, but anyway. Don, you are right. I ain't being very crazy this morning, am I? Now listen to me real good. I'll pick on these Wilson boys. I'll pick on these girls right here. You're sitting too close to the front. These boys right here. Jim Landis' boys. Did you know these boys right now are laying the foundation of trust? Did you, all you boys in church, all you girls, did you know what I've watched in this church for 20 years now? I've watched boys grow up and I've watched the men of this church watch the boys. And the men of this church are watching the boys to find out which ones they can trust, so they might hire them. I've watched it. And they'll see how they do in little things. If they do good in little things, and then they'll say, "Well, you know what? I might try him."
That's right. You preach that.
But if you're around here stuff and you're just lollygagging around, you're lying and you're piddling this and trying to get out of work here, and you always let somebody else do the hard stuff, and you don't take any responsibility, you're blowing your trust.
That's right.
Amen. It's exactly right. You don't know how far you can go, and you don't know what kind of blessings you might see if you'll be a boy and a girl of trust.
That's right.
Let me say this to girls. You walk around here, and I'll tell you something. Oh, yeah, you girls too. They're watching you. Then you're telling them whether you can be trusted just by your life.
That's right.
The way you dress, the way you act, the way you throw yourself around, they know whether they can trust you or not. And boys are looking for a girl they can trust. Amen. Yeah, thank you, Brother Mike. I appreciate you. Sick 'em howdy, amen. You know what? We need to have a shouting service sometime. Practice up for heaven. Glory to God, amen. The Bible said we're going to do it. You've got to study the word shout in the Bible. It'll get you away from them shrinks, amen. It'll take care of all your psychological needs. Shout her up. That's what the old timers did. They either went to the morning bench or the shouting, hollering. Both things will take care of each side of your emotional needs. You have no need of a pill or a shrink, either one. God will take care of it. But we don't do that around here. I'm just not that type of a person. Well, anyway, I won't go that trail. Earn your trust. Oh, Joseph was trustworthy, wasn't it? You know, every time Joseph got put somewhere, he went to the palace. He said, "My land, this boy can trust. I'll put everything in his care. I'm going to go off down to the lake." He got put in the prison. The prison master said, "Good land, this guy can be trusted. I'm putting everything in his care." The country got in trouble. They said, "Put Joseph in charge." Why? He was trustworthy. And let me tell you what, man. He was trustworthy in private. That's what made God let him be trustworthy in public. Because when Potiphar's wife tried to seduce him, he said, "How can I do this wicked thing and sin against my God?" And there wasn't nobody else around. And God said, "I can trust that boy right there. I'm going to put something in his hand." Amen. Jesus, by the way, is trustworthy this morning. Hey, you can hang your soul upon him. He'll never lie to you. If he said he'd save you, he'll save you. If he said he'd keep you, he'll keep you. If he said he's coming, he's a coming. Amen. Job said, "Yea, though he slay me, yet will I trust him." Well, that means, "Yea, though I get cancer, yet will I trust him. Yea, though I go broke, yet will I trust him. Yet though I'm sick, yet will I trust him. It don't matter what happens, I'm going to trust him. He's trustworthy." Amen. Well, I'll tell you what, listen, what time is it? Is it time to go home? Ain't dark, ain't short time yet. What time is it? No kidding. Quarter till. That was my introduction. Look at verse number 12. Verse number 12. Listen, we're just grazing. We're just having a good time. I ain't telling you nothing you don't already know. Ain't that right? That's what amen's all about. When you say amen, you're going, I know that. I know that. I know that. Amen. I know that. And I like that. Well, look at this thing. Now, listen, we're talking about getting into ministry here. We're talking about being entrusted with the gospel. He said, according to the glorious gospel, let us God must commend not to us. And now watch what he does. Now, boys, listen. Anybody here going to get called to preach, you better mark verse number 12 in your Bible. You're going to be a missionary. You're going to go into God's work of any kind. You better mark verse number 12. First of all, I think. I think. You ain't with a pinto bean with a wormhole both ends to nobody in God's business if you don't have a grateful heart. Amen. You ain't going to do no good. God likes grateful people. God likes people to say, thank you, thank you, thank you. Boy, I appreciate that. Thank you, I appreciate that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, God ain't going to use no little old soured up prune. Thinks the world owes him a living and everybody's after him. God saved his soul from hell, gave his son to die for him, and never looks up and says, thank you. Hey, you say, well, I don't know why God ain't using me. Maybe you're not very thankful. You want to be used of God. You want to be used in the ministry. You want God to bless you. Be happy and a thankful person. Amen. Amen. I'll tell you what. I had to say yesterday. I walked out of there. Me and Ben's getting ready to get in the truck. That lady standing down there. I've done thanked her once out there. I said, Ben, hold on just a minute. I said, I'll go down and thank these people, and then I'll be in the truck. I walked down into that tree. I said, Joy. I said, I just want to tell you again. Thank you for your business. Stuck my hand out there and told her husband, thank you for your business. They didn't have to hire me.
That's right.
Auctioneers and preachers, a dime a dozen.
They're everywhere.
They're everywhere. In fact, I think they might be about a nickel a dozen now.
Yeah.
Now you listen to me. You're going to be used of God. You can't act like that God really done the world a favor to save you. I am so holy, Reverend. Now God ain't going to use nobody like that. Paul sets the illustration here. If you're going to be in the ministry, be a thankful man. I mean, y'all say, honey, that was good cooking. Thank you. I don't think y'all leave your table without thanking your wife for the food she cooked. How many of you ladies say amen out there? Ain't no tell what you'd get cooked if you start saying, thank you, honey, that was good. Man, I'm telling you what, the other night, you boys, all boys that aren't married, plug your ears right now. Plug them right now. Plug them. My daughter, Sarah, this week, she made some kind of casserole. I don't know what it was. She made them special kind of biscuits that rises up and got that really neat stuff and that butter just melts down in them. She made the meat and the supper I ever seen. I said, if any young man ever finds out this woman could cook like that, I'll lose her in a fortnight. I'm telling you now, you listen to me, I looked at her, I said, I've told her that, and I've told her two or three times, I said, Sarah, that was good, we had it for leftovers again last night, it was better the second time than the first time, amen. Thank you, Sarah, that was good cooking, amen. You know why a lot of girls don't, who said that? You got your own daughters. Amen. Listen, man, I'm telling you something. Did you know why a lot of girls may not be interested in cooking? Because daddy and the brothers never said thank you to mama.
Yeah.
Hey, man, that's good. You women got your chance and you better be taking it. You might wish you had it for soon. No, listen, we need to thank. He said, I thank my Christ Jesus our Lord. Boy, we ought to thank him for the same things that Paul thanked him about. Amen. For saving us. How long has it been since you thank God for saving you? For forgiving you of all your sins. Woo! How long been you thank God for Jesus dying for you? And my land of living. How many this morning, I mean, if I walked in and said, hey, I've got deed, clear title deed and title insurance to a 462-acre farm with a river running through it. and a 3,500 foot new home on it and handed you the deed to it.
Amen.
Now, how many would think that anybody ought to say thank you to that? Well, bless your heart, Jesus Christ took off to heaven, the heavenly bridegroom, and he said, I go away and prepare a place for you. Woo! Oh, big deal. Man, well, I will be thankful. He has said, I've prepared a place for you. And if I prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am there, you may be also. Hey, he's going to give us a new glorified body. We've got a lot to be thankful for. Amen. If you want to get blessed, you want to get really blessed, you just start saying, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Amen. Yeah. Oh, I know. You've been... We're living in the American entitlement age. I didn't get my check on time this week. I'm calling the government up. I'm calling my representative. My Social Security disability that I cheated everybody out of didn't come. Get over it, okay? Amen, that's the truth. Tell them to get over it. Well, they didn't. I mean, I'm telling you what, people think they're entitled to everything. And all they're going to do is gripe and groan about it. They don't get it. Do you know what you deserve? Hell! I walked, two guys the other day at an auction I was at, there, and I walked up there and I said, how you guys doing? Pretty good. I said, how you doing? I said, better than I deserve. Oh, ho, we don't think so now. I said, yeah, I'd be in hell if I got what I deserved. They kind of went like that. That's what we deserve is hell. Well, be thankful. Amen. Anyway, I thank the Lord for loving me, talking with me. I thank Him for His mercy and His grace and His goodness. Thank Him for His holiness. I mean, He's been so good to me, hasn't He? Amen. God's been good to us. How can God use anybody who can't ever be thankful to Him for what He's done for them? Ungrateful attitude or even an apathetic attitude about things like that will damage your usefulness to God. And Paul knew it, and that's why he taught Timothy, I thank God. What time is it now? 10:10. I'm going to do one. No, we'll finish this verse 12 tonight. Now, I want you to look in your Bible there. There's three things about the ministry you need to get a hold of. Number one, who hath enabled me? Number two, counted me faithful. And number three, putting me in the ministry. Three of the most critical things you'll ever know about the ministry right there in that verse. Number one is this. Who hath enabled me? You need to get a hold of these three things. Now, I'm going to leave some of the rest of you, and I'm going to talk to some boys that God may call to preach, or go into ministry, or women, ladies that God may call to a specific type of ministry. Are you listening to me? A big hurdle, if you have any kind of right attitude about things, is that, man, I don't know how I could ever do that. You see, ministry work is supernatural work. True ministry is. Somehow or another, you intuitively know that I couldn't do this. I'm not up to this. I couldn't do that. Paul knew Timothy, if he had a right heart, would understand that. And he said, Timothy, he said, it is God that enables you to minister. I want to encourage somebody sitting here today, and I may never know who you are this side of eternity, but God's called you to preach. Some boy here, or maybe God will call you to preach someday. Let me tell you something. You better underline it in your Bible this morning. God, if He's called you, He will enable you. I cannot imagine. I was building fences when I was about 20 years old for a living, building farm fences. If you'd have walked up to me out there on the farm fence, I was a clipping barbed wire to a steel post, or digging a fence pole to set a brace, bareback, hair down to my shoulders, drinking at night. If you'd have walked up to me and said, God is going to call you and entrust you with all that I know of now, I'd looked at him and said, somebody ought to grab him quick and put him back where he got out of. That man lost his mind. And let me tell you something. I got married, and then God really began to deal with me.
That was a big deal. I can't do it, man. I can't do that. Now, some of it was, I won't do that. We say it can't because some things is we won't. But I just want to encourage you today. Elijah, God calls you. He'll enable you. Now, how does enabling come? Enabling comes through the grace of God. And I'll tell you what, that's one of the neatest things in the world to experience is the enabling grace of God. As we humble ourselves and submit to God and obey the Lord, then God enables us to do what He's called us to do. So it's the same thing really about being a husband, wife, father, whatever it is. God gives you the grace, it enables you to do what He's asked you to do. What may seem impossible, and in your flesh you know, man, I couldn't do that. God will enable you to do it. I don't, somehow or another, I can't seem to get this across like I'm wanting to. But I will tell you this, that God enabled Moses. Moses said, Lord, I've got that. God said, you go. He said, well, he makes excuses. I'll let Aaron be your mouth. They got down there. Aaron wasn't the mouth. He enabled Moses to do it. He said, man, I could never preach. Yeah, you could if God enables you.
Amen.
You can if God enables you. I tell you what, one time I was down in somewhere in the Carolinas or somewhere at a preaching conference down there, and there was no boy got up. He's just a young boy. And he's a big old boy. And I tell you what, that boy didn't say three words, but you knew he come way back in where the ticks are from. I mean, he's a back in the hill boy. And he got up and preached a message entitled, you know, I've heard a lot of preaching. This little boy got up, hadn't been preaching very long, and he preached a message. Where's everybody at? I can still remember him preaching that message. You know why I remember him preaching that message? Because God enabled him. He got up there and he said, you know, I ain't been preaching very long. Said, I just got my first church. Said, he said, but I'm all fired up. Said, I want to do something for God. Boy, I mean, hear what he was fired up. But he said, he got up there and said, I told church on Sunday morning. Said, he said, we're going to have prayer meeting on Wednesday night. We're going to have Wednesday night prayer meeting in this church. And he said, I was always out. He said, Wednesday night. I said, there wasn't nobody there. And I said, where's everybody at? And you know what his text was? Listen to this. You know what his text was? It was about Uriah when David sent him back to Joab and told Joab to send him to the forefront of the battle and all the other men to pull back and let him die. And he said, I'll imagine that Uriah was fighting for his king and for the country. And he turned around and everybody's gone. Where's everybody at? And man, I'm going to tell you, that man preached like a wild man for about an hour. Where's everybody at? And I'm going to tell you what, I bet you he couldn't spell knowledge. He might be able to spell knowledge. I bet you he wasn't an A student. I bet you it wasn't a speech class he ever took in his life. But he could preach because God enabled him to preach. And he got grace to do it. And I'm going to tell you something. Abraham was enabled. Gideon was enabled. Samson was enabled. Peter was enabled to walk on water. David was enabled to kill Goliath. Noah was enabled to build an ark. Daniel was enabled to be in the lion's den. I'm just saying that's all God does with His people is enable them. Never say you couldn't. You don't know what you could accomplish when God enables you. Amen? You have the power of God with you. D.L. Moody. You know what D.L. Moody? This honest truth. In his Bible, on the side notes like this. See this Bible? It's got this white space on the side of it. You make little notes there. He's got all kinds of misspelled words. That guy couldn't spell cat hardly right. But he turned two continents upside down for God. You know why? Because one day he was sitting around and he got to thinking what God would do with one man who was wholly given to spreading the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. Did you know they invited him to England? And did you know he went to, I believe it's, I could be wrong, if I'm wrong, correct me, but I think it's either Oxford or Cambridge. And they invited him to preach to the student body. And he got up there and one of the first words out of his mouth, it would be like me saying, y'all. And that whole student body snickered and shut him off. Because he wasn't intellectual enough for those Oxford and Cambridge kids. And in fact, when Ira Sankey sang, they almost laughed him off the podium. But you know what they did?
Old D.L. Moody and Ira Sankey went to praying.
And he come back that night and he preached the power of God fell, and they forgot about whether he could pronounce words right and spell right. And people started getting right with God, and they had revival at that college. Why? Because God could enable him. And I want to just say something, just as straight gun barrel as I can to you boys. If God calls you, He will enable you if you'll humble yourself and get the grace of God. It doesn't matter who you are and how, what kind of grades you made in school. Yeah, you ought to do the best you can. But it's if God enable you. That's the question. Amen. And let me tell you the secret to it is. And when you surrender, it's like diving off a diving board. You don't dive off a diving board kind of halfway and decide to, you know. Well, I'm going to go back up and try that one again. No, you done gone, buddy. So when you surrender, you just let her fly. You give it all to God. And you know what? I found out in 3 weeks' time in my life, God had totally changed me. You know what He done? He took the fear out of people out of me. It's just still that way. How many knows near? I really don't give a rip too bad about whether you like my preacher or not. They've come and went by the dozens around here. I mean, I love everybody, but you know what? I've done a long time ago, figured out the fear of man bringeth a snare. And you'll never be worth nothing to God if you're scared of people. There was another bad word, a scared. That ain't in the dictionary, is it? You know the news, catch that jug, don't you? But listen to me. You've got to understand God will enable you. You say, oh, I don't want any more children. I couldn't. God will enable you if you'll get on your face and cry out to Him. Get in this book and pray and live and do right. God will enable you to be a mother of many. Amen. Yeah. God will enable you to have those children. Oh, we can't afford them. God will enable you. Now, I'll tell you what will happen to you if you ain't careful. If you'll trust God, them kids will grow up and buy you a brand new car. Amen. I heard Travis talking to his kids last Sunday after that. You give yours a talk too? Okay. All right. The only thing was I scared my mom and dad's going to look at me and say, where's ours? But they hadn't yet. Well, I thought about it. Listen to me. God's ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. God is so good. God enables us. Amen. I'm telling you, God, we can do things we don't think we can do if we'll just humble ourselves and let God. And I'm telling you, if you're going to get into ministry, God says, hey, I ain't calling you to ministry until you go up there all by yourself. Buddy, I'm going to tell you something. He'll be right here. Right here. I got to go preach a revival in Kentucky. He'll be there before I get there. I got to go preach a revival in Arkansas. He'll be there before I get there. Let's stand to home.